10th, 2015, regular meeting of the Town of Easton Planning and Zoning Board. So let's jump right in. Up first tonight, we have a internally illuminated sign application for 682 Depot Street. Mr. Timothy Fisher. Why don't you step on up, have a seat, Mr. Fisher? Welcome.
Thank you.
Do you have anything you want to add to your application?
Or nope.
Okay. Gary, do you have?
I do not. No. Well, just as a note, there are two signs tonight for that address.
Yeah.
This is the first sign to be looked at is the freestanding sign. It's an additional sign that's allowed by the bylaw.
Board members, any questions?
Actually, yeah, so these two new signs, they're in addition to the one that's over the doorway. That are there going to be two signs or three signs on the property?
The sign that's you're specifically referring to is a monument sign to be placed out in front of the property.
Yes.
For all tenants. That's the first sign that you're speaking of now.
Okay, right, yeah. So then the second sign coming up is the one off to the side of the doorway.
The second sign, which I was not aware of, is not on this print right here. By not aware of, I'm aware of the sign. I thought that was the next meeting. I'm familiar with that sign, so we can talk about it. But currently, there's one occupant inside this building. Verica Construction is the person we're doing the work for regarding this monument sign, and that's for all tenants within the building. The second sign that I believe is on the agenda that I wasn't aware of as far as this evening goes, that is for urgent care. He's looking for an additional wall sign on the side of his building facing Shaw's parking lot. He basically has approximately 18 square feet right now. Currently, I believe the law provides for 100. As one sign. He's looking for, with the small square footage that he is occupying, he's looking for that identity over into the parking lot for Shaw's, for the traffic.
Seems like a good idea. And then the second sign will just be for the future tenant. They'd come with their own application.
At that point, there will be a third sign on the building.
Yes.
And that's for the future tenant, correct?
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
Gary, maybe you can refresh my memory, because yes. For some reason I can't access the minutes. I know this, I want to talk about the signs on the building.
On the building.
No, first of all, I can't access the application. So are we dealing just with the freestanding sign tonight?
It sounds like it. There are two applications in the system. This one is for the freestanding sign. There's an additional one for a second wall sign, identical to a wall sign that the board has already approved. That a second wall sign would require variance from the ZBA, but the applicant's aware of that.
And actually, wouldn't it be a third wall sign? Because weren't they proposing a sign under the arch?
There is a sign on the arch. There is
an revised version.
Right, yes, there's a sign on the arch. There is an urgent care sign. And this new proposed wall sign is identical to that urgent care sign. But it sounds like the applicant maybe isn't ready for that to be heard.
I'm ready to discuss it if you'd like to. I wasn't sure if money's had to be paid. I'm not totally involved in that end of the process.
Well, it would have to go to ZBA first.
There's
really no sense with us acting on it.
Okay.
Until, because the variance is going to be required, because mm-hmm. two have already been approved.
Okay.
So I would say we just take that off the
that's fine.
The slate yep. for tonight, and we just deal with the freestanding sign. So we have the plan before us. Anybody on the board, do we have any questions regarding the freestanding sign or any comments?
I was wondering, is it LED or is it fluorescent?
It's fluorescent. We have encouraged the owner of the property as well as the tenants to go with a more subtle indirect lighting. The letter set that you referred to that is on the building currently, that's a halo lit letter, so by evening you just have the white shadow. And this particular sign, the faces will not illuminate by evening. The only thing that will light up is the copy. The street address will not light up by evening either. So the lighting here is very subtle.
Okay. But it's fluorescent, not LED.
It is fluorescent, correct. But you'd never be able to tell through the dark color red what it is. It's already going to be...
Yeah, I was thinking it more just for energy conservation rather than, you know, color, light and color, yep. Whatever. I don't have any further questions.
Okay. Deb or Dave? No. All right, so would someone care to make a motion?
Motion to approve the sign as presented.
I'll second it.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Opposed? Abstain? Motion passes. Thank you.
Great, thank you.
All right, next up is 233 Rare Lincoln Street, William Adams Trustee. Form A review. Expect him in?
I don't believe so. No, I spoke with the engineer on this today. This is an endorsement of an approval not required plan on Lincoln Street. The board should have received a very brief memo from me indicating a few things that I identified that were that did not meet the board standards of the plan, including the location of abutters across Lincoln Street and the address of the parcel in question. So those have been added to the plan that we have for the board to sign. That plan meets the requirements of the of an A&R by the board. So I would say that there's nothing preventing the board from endorsing the plan this evening, unless you have other questions.
Okay, and I see that the address on the agenda doesn't match the address on the plan, but I'm assuming where it's a Form A, that does not matter.
Correct.
As long as we have town council now.
Well, just so long as the notice is correct, that it's the same property and that the, you know, on the agenda.
Yes, the agenda item cites one of the lots to be changed.
I mean, it's A&R, it's not the same notice requirements as if it was a special permit, so yeah. I don't worry about it too much, but your agenda should be accurate.
Okay.
As long as it's reasonably accurate.
I would say it's reasonably accurate.
Motion to endorse A&R plans as submitted.
Hearing a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Motion passes. Excuse me. 305 Depot Street has requested a continuance until our September 8th meeting. So granted. And next up is site plan review for 134-140 Main Street. 140 Main Holly LLC. Gentlemen, want to set up? I'm sure you know the drill by now.
Yep. Brian McCarthy with R.J. O'Connell Associates with Civil Engineers.
Brian, I'm sorry. If you gentlemen could use the microphone, that'd be helpful. You can pick it right up there.
I'll sing.
Karaoke.
Welcome.
Hello? Is it on? Yep. Brian McCarthy with R.J. O'Connell Associates, Civil Engineers for the project. The business we're talking about is located at 140 Main Street. On this board here is the darker color, former church building that was located in that area. We got Mechanic Street, Main Street, Sullivan Ave on that side. And 150 Main in the corner here. The business here, the project is that's proposed is to renovate the existing building and change the use of the building. Previous building was retail sales of sheet music, King sales. And the proposal is to renovate that building and change the use to a couple of different things. There would be a restaurant use in there on the upper level on this side of the building. There would be a microbrewery use on the lower level on this side of the building. And the remaining space in there would be made up of like a retail and office type spaces. The at the back of these buildings is an alleyway that services all the businesses along Main Street here. There's parking along that alleyway. And that is set lower than Main Street. So the lower level of these actually opens out right onto the alley in the back, and there's access doors and so on right off the back, so you can come right in that way. The renovation will include improving the front of the building with stairways and ramps in accordance with the ADA requirements for accessibility. And we'll be doing, we'll be installing a grease trap out here for the restaurant use. The restaurant proposed is 76 seats, and it is about 1,900 square feet in area. And the microbrewery section on the lower level of this is 40 seats roughly, and about 1,600 square feet. So the total, and then the retail piece is about 600, retail office on this side is about 620 square feet. And on the other side, we have about 1,600 square feet. And on this side, the lower level will be about 1,900 square feet of retail and office space. So that's really the proposal. I know there's been some discussion related to parking on this. This plan shows you the existing building had, and the lot actually is the darker line, the lot that goes with this property. There's approximately 7 spaces located on the property. And in the past, all these businesses here have been using the on-street parking, the common alleyway parking for the uses, and also the municipal parking lot, which is located right over here, which has had about 58 spaces over here. There's about 27 spaces on Main Street.
Total municipal parking between there and Sullivan is 146, not including going down in front of the mound.
So that's pretty much what the proposal is.
Okay. Gary, what is the memo? I can't find it on here.
No, it should be in either staff memo, or I'm going to put it under site plan.
Okay. So, Gary, do you have any?
Go to the agenda.
Copy.
Go to the agenda. There's a link that'll take you to.
The memo. The memo from the applicant, Greg, or my memo?
Go to the.
From the applicant.
Yeah. If you go.
That's okay. Let's move on. I'll find it. Just for some, the link's not working for some reason. Okay. So do you care to?
Sure.
Comment, Gary.
So the board should have received the memo from me dated August 3rd. And it starts with a discussion on the conformity with the master plan. Certainly, the revitalization of Main Street conforms with the master plan. There's a lot to like about this proposal. Namely, this proposal looks at prioritizing infill development and redevelopment activities in areas that are already sewered, which the master plan calls out. Maintaining and building upon existing and commercial centers, which Main Street is obviously one, and rehabilitating a historic asset. I would note that this is in the Ames Local Historic District, so any changes to the exterior of the property have to go.
We've already been in front of the Historic Commission. We're meeting with them on the 22nd, I believe it is, to do a walk through outside and inside. We've shown a bunch of different plans. I'm not sure when we're back on the agenda, but it's the next meeting.
Okay.
And we're meeting with them before that on site to walk them through it.
Fantastic. Okay. In terms of zoning, this is zone business. Right now, it's an allowable use. Both uses are allowed by right. Both the restaurant use and also what would be considered a manufacturing and packaging use that's allowed in combination with other uses, which would be allowed here. Currently, the property has been used as a sheet music store, I believe. Is that the case?
Yep.
All right.
Retail.
Retail. Fair enough. Of course, no landscaping or anything like that has been proposed as part of this proposal. That's goes with the existing conditions, which limit the relevance of that type of requirement in the board's regulations. The big question here, as we've discussed and is outlined in my memo, is about parking. So I'm just going to read that section of my memo, just to be clear about what we're talking about here. So the bylaw requires 40 dedicated off-street parking spaces for the uses as proposed. And that would be 30 spaces for the restaurant and microbrewery, and 10 spaces for the office and retail uses. So 40 spaces total. 7, as mentioned, off-street spaces are proposed on the property. And 4 of those are currently or historically used by the tenants of 150 Main Street. Site constraints obviously limit the potential of additional on-site parking on the property. However, there appears to be a potential for accommodating additional spaces on nearby off-site locations, which would potentially be within 200 feet of the property, which would meet the requirements of the bylaw. I would ask the applicant to address where and how dedicated off-street parking nearby is to be located. Some number of additional dedicated off-street spaces, coupled with the availability of some parking spaces within both the municipal lot, as mentioned, and on the street, would provide the board some flexibility in lowering the off-street parking requirements by some percentage. To note, as of August 3rd, or actually today, the board may reduce the number of required off-street spaces by up to 50%, or in this case, 20 spaces. At the 2015 annual town meeting, the town approved changing the bylaw to allow the planning board to reduce the number of spaces by more than 50%, but that change is still being reviewed by the Attorney General's office. Once the town receives that approval from the Attorney General, the planning board may reduce the requirement by more than 50% if it so chooses. I'd also note that the location of any off-street spaces, off-site spaces, must be approved by the Zoning Board of Appeals. If those are within 200 feet of the property, those can be simply a determination by the Zoning Board of Appeals that off-site spaces would be appropriate. Or beyond 200 feet, that would have to be a variance through the Zoning Board of Appeals. So that's what the bylaw says about parking. Obviously, there's some flexibility built in there for the board. And then finally, public safety. You see there's some comments made by Chief Partridge there to ensure the safety of the public. And I noted the significance of the Ames Local Historic District as well. No issues in terms of stormwater. There's no real change in conditions there or wastewater. So again, obviously parking is the major issue here. Other than that, I don't see a lot of other issues. And those are my comments.
Thank you, Gary.
Thank you.
You want me to address?
No, and actually, you know what? As long as we have town council in the house, I think I would like to, for my own ignorance, get clarity on a few issues. So as I understand it, first of all, what is the date? Do we know what the deadline is for the AG?
I believe it's 90 days from town meeting.
Right, I know it's 90 days, but do we know the actual date?
It would be really soon. Sometimes the AG asks for extensions, and that's usually between the town clerk and the AG. I'm not aware of an extension here. It should be coming right up. Okay, I'm getting AG approvals in other towns right now.
Okay. So I guess going forward, you know, hypothetically, if we were to consider approving something that had less than 50% of required parking, I understand that's at the applicant's peril, but would we be allowed to vote before we heard from the AG, or is that something we wait till we hear finally?
It's a tricky area. You know what, I should probably be out of my
head. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, you're right.
That's a tricky area, Greg. This comes up every year because town meetings adopt zoning very often because there's projects in the pipeline, so they want to get them moving. I've generally taken the position, because once the zoning is approved, it's then retroactive back to town meeting, that you could generally proceed under something, but again, it's at the peril of the applicant. It requires notice and, you know, all the other things on the agenda. It has to be spelled out. The requirements aren't altogether different than the current procedure that you have now, which is a little bit of a quirky procedure legally, but it does function. So, yeah, and you could use it, and I'm not aware of any cases that say you can't, but again, no decision could be used at that time,
right?
Until the time that it's approved.
Okay, and one more question. And again, I'm not saying I'm proposing this, just to educate an ignorant man. In our existing bylaw, our tables refer to required parking, and under section 8.9, subsection. Bear with me here. Where's the reduction? To subsection. This always happens when I'm on TV. Okay, I guess it's 13. Right now, it currently reads the Planning and Zoning Board may reduce the required parking, subsection 8.6, in the amount of not more than 50% to specific site or public safety considerations. And basically, I don't have the new wording in front of us, but basically it says, it just takes out the 50%, you know. And then it further, again, where's that 200-foot one? Why can't I find that?
That's under 8.6, I believe, or 8.4.
Oh, that's right, it's before. That's what I can't find. Ah, here we go. So required off-street parking, section 8.5, right? Required off-street parking shall be provided, et cetera. Same lot as the principal use they are required to serve. When practical difficulties as determined by the Board of Appeals prevent their establishment upon the same lot, they shall be established no further than 200 feet from the premises. So my question is this, because I have a real issue with, we talk about dedicated spaces, because I've lived in town for almost 30 years now, and there's a lot of businesses down there, and I don't know how we're going to dedicate who's going to park for this business and this business and this business. It's really more of a cumulative. And I also become concerned when I continually hear talk about, oh, we need to have peer review. Because I'd like to think as a community, folks that drive, I'd rather sometimes put my faith in folks that drive up and down the street 15 to 20 times a day, and folks that walk a street at 11 o'clock at night and maybe run it at 4 in the morning or 5 in the morning, not me. And so, you know, peer review sometimes works great, but, you know, it was also members of this board that discovered errors in peer review at Quesit Commons after a 5-minute visit, a 3-foot difference in grading. And peer review got us the wonderful septic mound, which I understand had to be located there. But I think if we had involved some folks that are a little bit more in the fabric of the community, we could have come up with a better solution, even in that location. So with that, all that being said, I could see a possible solution here where if the applicant is able to come up with some, you know, 30-odd spaces off-site that he can dedicate. We all know, I mean, let's cut to the chase. We all know what's going on in town here with issues, with anger. Could we possibly approve, you know, would town council have an issue if we approved a building, if we approved the use of a building, knowing there was dedicated off-street parking past the 500 feet, or even under the new bylaw, are you saying that still has to go to ZBA?
Yeah, the bylaw allows you to reduce right now 50%. It doesn't say anything, any limiting factor. It says you're allowed to reduce by 50% the dedicated parking. You can do that for whatever reason you decide, and there are many reasons you could do that.
Yeah.
What you can't do is say something that isn't in the bylaw. For example, if there are dedicated spaces off-site, then that obviously is going to have to go to the ZBA, either for a determination or for a variance, period. And you can use publicly available parking spaces as a means to reduce, but you can't use it as in terms of the count itself, or no one can, the zoning board or you. Right now, I mean, we're working towards a set of bylaws and thinking of where we may be able to examine shared uses using municipally available spaces. That doesn't exist yet in town, but we're certainly moving in that direction. And as are a lot of towns that I'm working with. Parking is a difficult question everywhere, not just Easton. It is for big, small projects of all kinds. It comes down to parking and drainage a heck of a lot.
Yeah, and forgive me, folks at home, I wasn't very succinct in my last one. But you know, here's my issue. You know, it's no surprise to anybody that downtown there's a block of buildings that basically have no parking. You know, the current building, the current church, if we were to give it a retail, I guess we'd call it a retail use, it's sheet, you know, has a requirement of 17 spaces. There's no 17 spaces there. If we gave it a business use, it would have 42 required spaces. If it was a church, I don't know how many seats were in there originally, but it would be a parking space for every 5 seats. And there's been a lot of talk by a lot of people on boards and private citizens of of renovating and rejuvenating downtown. And if we, you know, I guess I wish as a town we started to deal with this parking issue 2 years ago and not 2 months ago, because I don't think it's not serving our town very well. And I hope through this process that we are able to come up with some off-site parking that will perhaps allow us to waive the requirement for parking. As we know, we've been working on new zoning to propose at special town meeting this fall for downtown. And one of the issues we've been looking at is this this small zone we have downtown that's zero lot lines and has no parking. And I don't know, there's talk of, you know, possible municipal lots, public-private partnerships. Hopefully, in the next series of meetings here, we can come up with a solution that will allow projects to go forward without having to wait 2 or 3 years for parking lots to be built. So that's my diatribe. So you guys said you're done with your presentation, right? So what I'd like to do first, why don't we do this? Since you guys already presented, I'd like to open it up to the board now. And then we'll open it up to the public, and then we can circle back. So does anybody on the board have any questions or comments regarding the project? Feel free.
I have a quick question. Does the microbrewery have a front door?
It does.
Yeah.
The thought process is, as we redeveloped the whole back and as parks got built and so forth, the front door would be in the back, would be in the alley, and there's two accesses to it. It'd be all landscaped, you know, along here, and that would be the front door to that. And then the lower level, there'd be a front door there. Yeah, you can probably see it a little better. The front door to the brewery would be here. There'd be another access here. And then underneath this, there'd be bathrooms, and there'd be a workout facility. You know, the problem I'm running into now is I don't even know if I'm going to have a restaurant tenant, because I can't tell them that I can build it in any normal amount of time.
That's all for now.
Okay, thanks, Peter. Wayne, did you have something?
On the point of accessibility, I know you were adding a ramp structure between the two buildings there.
Yes.
Are there any accessible parking spots in the area?
Let me tell you.
Look more private.
Let me tell you what there is. There's 4 to 5 spots here, no matter how you count it. Then there's 6, 7, 8, probably 9 spots here. Then up in.
Just here in the
other properties that I own where there's parking spots available, there's a total of about 14 between what I own in front of the next to Children's Museum and available spots here after the business is closed down. So there's currently, you know, 14 and 8 is, you know, 22 spots.
So
spots that I currently own right now that would be available for this, because, you know, 114, you really can't take it into consideration.
I'm primarily concerned with, sure, you know, a handicapped person who has a van that needs to pull out.
There are handicap spots right in front, and you know, we have Ms. talked, yeah, about, I believe, the handicap spots right here, and then you come up and down, and you know, I think last meeting we were talking about potentially adding another handicap spot there. There are also handicap spots in the parking lot back here that brings you up to the street and then down. But maybe something, one more closer to, if that does become a restaurant, absolutely. And if the other store ever opens.
Sure. Thank you.
What's the distance from the building we're discussing tonight and the park area that was proposed behind 114 Main Street? Do you know?
I would say
160. Like a 200-foot distance from this property would actually run right about, right? It would take into account that park area and a piece of the municipal property.
And I know you've been working on this for a while, so I'm sure you've looked at a lot of scenarios. Have you ever done any preliminary layouts? Have you looked at perhaps putting, because you know, as I say, I get concerned with this dedicated parking because it's just not going to be realistic, it's not enforceable. But I could see a situation where maybe a temporary parking lot, as we wait for, you know, more parking to happen downtown, you know, in lieu of the park. It seems to me you could probably get, I don't know, 25, 30 spaces.
We get almost 38 spots there. And, you know, I have written a letter to the Board of Selectmen requesting that they meet with me due to the pending litigation on 114 and the ZBA's, whatever they did with the denial, whatever they want to call it, for the sole purpose of looking at 114 and downsizing it and potentially taking the park and building parking spots back there. To this point, they've rejected it, but we're still going to pursue it. I think, you know, temporary parking there would be great. I think it would serve, you know, would allow this quarter of Main Street to get built and to go further. You know, we've also proposed to the town almost over a month and a half, 2 months ago now, we requested that they meet with us on the current park that is behind the Snow Grove Park that is behind King's Building. We propose to potentially relocate the whole park at no cost to the town and build a parking lot there that would house close to 70, 75 parking spots back there and combine that park with a current park that is somewhat dilapidated on Pine Street in Easton. In this park itself, I mean, there are some T-ball games that happen there, very few. I mean, it's really, I don't want to use the word rundown, but it needs work. And it seems like that it would be a logical solution to be able to control this amount of parking for the downtown. There's already some easements in place through Mr. King's lot to get back there. It would solve so many problems in the downtown. And like I say, no one's completely listening right now, but I propose that I would build the parking lot at my cost, relocate the parking lot to the park at my cost, and I just don't, I don't know where that's at right now. But
just don't put another restaurant back there. Well, yeah, I mean, I know there's a lot of folks. I know Gary and his staff are working on some stuff. And, you know, my concern, and you know, anybody that comes to these meetings or watches it knows I'm not the most formal chair. But, you know, I'm a resident of this town. We're all residents of this town. And there's things a lot bigger than us, I guess, going on that we're not privy to and don't really understand. But it's a shame to see things that the entire town's been excited about and a lot of the board's been working towards suddenly come into conflict. So, you know, my thought, and, you know, if 114, let's say, had been approved, and let's say you were building that right now and you came to us with this, personally, I would be concerned, like, okay, where are we, you know, where are we putting it? We'd have to work out a solution. But as far as I can tell, 114 is sort of in limbo for a while, whether it's redesign, you know, stuff that doesn't involve us. But you know, I think I would like to say I think a great solution that would be an expedient solution because we could keep it to one board. It's easy to dedicate parking out behind that building right now. You know, for these two restaurants, and you know, temporary solution. And I know you've been working out there quite a bit, so I'm assuming you know a lot of. So if that's to me, if that's something you're willing to do, and of course you have to work it out with other folks, but I think that's, for the town, to me, that's a a very sensical solution, sort of a temporary Band-Aid, not the final solution. There's certainly issues that come up with putting the traffic down towards Mechanic Street, but nothing that we couldn't manage with some signs. And I think we need to get back to working together as a town. You know, I heard in one of the meetings that didn't involve us, and with all due respect to everybody that's involved, everybody's certainly welcome to have their opinion, but when I heard someone throw out the idea that we need to hire engineers to stand out in front of the restaurant when it opens to see what happens with the traffic, well, isn't that what residents do? You know, don't we? Can't we handle if we have a traffic jam? So, you know, I hope we can work as a community to come up with some good, smart, expedited solutions. Because I think that would be wise as a 30-year resident. And if I'm speaking beyond my pay grade, well, I don't get paid anyway, so what the heck.
Well, Greg, as a 28-year resident, you have 2 years on me, you know, I'd like the board to look at the fact that, you know, we do have 22 spaces available right now that we could dedicate to that, and that's half of what is required for parking. We all know the municipal parking lot, the downtown, there are parking spots there. You also are aware that I have a license agreement with King for 80-some-odd spots back here. The parking's there. You know, I've got my warm dock shell permit now, and what that means is I can strip out the inside of the church. I can start making not tenant improvements, but improvements to the building itself. Like, it needs electrical, it needs new plumbing, it needs all that, and get that all up to code and get that ready. So then when I come in with the tenant packages, I can proceed with it. But the problem is, I can't proceed with tenant packages until I get site plan approval. And, you know, I've already lost one tenant there, and believe it or not, I had all three rented other than one space up above that is a retail space that I'm sure will rent relatively quickly. But what Greg just articulated is the more we push this out and the more we push this off, you know, the longer it's going to take for anything to happen down there. At least here, you know, we're building a corner. We're getting started, you know, and then we're solving, like I say, I'm standing in front of the public. I'm saying that I'm going to build a parking lot back here that's going to cost me $500,000 or $600,000 out of my own cost to help the downtown, to help the, you know, and I'm sure some people may have some heartache over that, and we may have to manipulate it a little, make it a little different, you know, but on paper, there's 70-something spots back there. And, you know, I'm in constant contact with the Children's Museum. You know, I know their functions. I know it's a problem. You know, we've talked to them about potentially having some of their, if it's at night, parking down at 50 Oliver and then busing them up to get, you know, get it under control a little. And, you know, it's something that, you know, we know that as we develop the downtown, as all the business owners, we need to get together and figure out how to manage the traffic along with the town instead of just having it become a quagmire. You know, we've actually done a study, gone to every single business in the downtown. We've asked them what time they open in the morning, how many clients they have per hour, what days of the week are they open. We're actually very close to having it completed, along with a graph that will show that currently, even if we built 114 Main, with everything we got right here in this parking, it would be sufficient, along with this right here, would be sufficient for the for what's needed there. I know we're not talking about that now, but we're talking about this little piece, and we're talking about if the board looked at 50% of the count, you know, at 22 spaces, they're available.
Okay. And Garrett, what is the status? I know you talked about there was a build-out analysis being done.
Yeah, we're working on doing a parking study for the downtown, a very, you know, large-scale kind of aerial view, looking at how many, similar to what Mr. Howe just said, how many spaces are we going to need in a full build-out of downtown? How many spaces do we need, both municipal and private, all together? How many spaces do we need? That's a question that everybody's asking. How will circulation work? How will shared parking work? That's a question that I think everybody wants an answer to, and we're working.
But shared parking is, you know, it's hard to, it's like who parks there first? If it's a municipal parking spot, anyone's entitled to it who goes anywhere. It's in, and I know it's difficult because, you know, of the way the zoning laws read right now, but at the end of the day, you know, we're not going to tell the Children's Museum that they can't park here. In turn, you know, I'm not going to try to edge them out of their parking. We're showing that most of their functions are done by 4:30. That parking lot clears out, other than the guy that's rebuilding his engine and some other guy, a couple other guys there. It's you know, it's very accessible from 5 o'clock on. This parking lot, these parking spaces, other than, you know, you got to take into consideration when there's a you know, function here, then there's a night function at the Children's Museum. And that's something that, you know, Children's Museum, their last function, they had 1,500 people attend it. Okay, there wasn't a single accident. There probably was some complaints about the parking, but it's my point is, when you look at what we're talking about right here, it's minuscule compared to what's happened down there during parking events.
Right, and so this study is not meant to be punitive towards anybody. It's meant to be, you know, what we as a town want to see downtown successful and downtown vibrant. So how do we do that, and how does parking become a piece of that?
Well,
could I ask a question?
Could
I ask a question?
So Jen, I just wanted to follow. Okay. So is the study ongoing?
We have to go out for quotes for it. So we've
okay. So it's far away. Okay.
Well,
go ahead.
Not that far, but I was going
to
ask.
I think they'll be able to use ours. We expect. I'm telling my guys tomorrow, but we expect probably by Thursday, Friday, we'll be able to have something to submit to all the boards. And I was just going to open up. I was going to put it online and kind of show what we've come up with. In.
Fantastic. Sounds good.
But I think the point here is, you know, if the board would look at this as half the parking needed, you know, there are 22 spots available.
Could you just lay that out? That was going to be my question. Could you just lay out? I don't think we've seen that. That hasn't been submitted. So what are the 22 spaces?
Eight spots right here, between here and here. Okay. Up in here, I got 14 spots. There's four spots, actually six spots, not even shown right here. It's my property. The Children's Museum rents it from me up to the garage, and all they use is a garage. I've already talked to them. I've told them, listen, the only thing you're renting is a garage. So during the day, you're welcome to use it, but at night, I need those parking spots. And I can get at least six cars in there. And, you know, we might end up flip-flopping and starting some valet here to get things and try it out. And, you know, that's something that I have to go in front of the Board of Selectmen to get them to allow me what they've already approved here to move it back here and kind of figure out that valet system while we figure out the rest of the quagmire.
So I think we need to see that plan. The board needs to see that.
Yeah,
we have this plan.
Right, but just one thing I think is important.
They don't have this plan.
We don't have that plan.
One thing I think we need to, everyone, this board, the applicant, staff, we need to look at this realistically. And the fact that, okay, under the current bylaw, we can reduce it 50%, but that doesn't mean you're going to have only 50% of your restaurant filled. You know? We can do a build-out analysis, but, you know, there's always going to be subjectiveness to that. It's just numbers. You know, is this building going to have, you know, is this proposed use in this scenario going to have required 100 parking spaces or 10, right? But I think for site plan review, for what we're looking at here today, I think we need to just, it's pretty finite. We're looking at a restaurant that requires, or a use that requires about 40 parking spaces. If I could open the file, I can tell you that more. I can. And we know, okay, in the vicinity, there's the 150 building that you've been working on, and there's the existing. So I would like to think that as a community, and, you know, folks at home, we're on TV for a reason. So I hope you get involved and you contact us or you contact the department or you show up at meetings and don't just write angry things online. And let's hear from the residents and the businesses in the area. Let's work out a solution on this. And maybe we find, you know what? there is enough right now. I mean, we looked at 114 as a board, and it was, wow, upwards of 275 seats. And, well, what are you going to do the night that Children's Museum has something going on, and, you know, you guys have a wedding, and, you know, but we looked and we said, you know, with the master plan, with economic development, all of the historical preservation, all the things we've been talking about, we can solve these issues as a town. Well, it's sort of gone beyond that now. To me, this is a much smaller issue to set. We're only talking 40 cars versus, you know, 100 plus. So maybe I want to find is the solution, you know, and Gary and I talk a lot, and he's been saying a lot, you know, we really dedicated spaces. Well, yeah, so maybe temporarily, you know, maybe the solution is so that you can get going on this thing and you don't lose your tenants, and the town can benefit from, you know, two more restaurants and more business down there and less for sale signs. You know, maybe the solution has to be a temporary parking lot, or maybe not. But I think we need to just deal with real numbers, and as a committee, you know, look at that and talk to our fellow citizens and our, you know, town staff, and try to see if we're going to be able to come up with a solution.
So, you know, my point is, there's 146 municipal parking spots that there's nothing open at night downtown. Other than Farmer's Daughter on Thursday, Friday night, and it's very small. Who's going to park in all these spots? You got to look at it realistically, and you got to say, you know, there's more than ample parking for these two facilities. And I'm going to lose the tenants. I'm going to lose my drive to build this, because it's to a point now where it's borderline whether it's even worth it, just from an aggravation standpoint. And I know that you can't take that into consideration, but that's why the for sale signs are there. And I get calls every day on them. And I don't want to do that. I'm a 28-year resident here, and I want this to work, but someone's got to bend and someone's got to help. Because, you know, the parking really, when it comes down to brass tacks, isn't completely my problem. It's, you know, it's a town issue. It's a developer issue. There's more than ample parking for this building alone by miles. And anyone who can add can figure out 140, 150 municipal spots. Well, you only need 40. The brewery's only open 3 days a week from, you know, 4 o'clock till 8 o'clock or something like that. The other spots that you're grabbing is for facilities that are going to be open during the day. So you're really talking about a 50 seat, you know, 60 seat, sushi restaurant that you divide by four, and that's what you're dealing with for parking. It's really not, you know, you look at all the numbers cumulative, but it's, you got to look at what they are. Yes.
Greg, I have a question. I was looking at the sushi restaurant and the microbrewery, and I'm wondering, I mean, on here you've got 76 seats for the restaurant and 43 for the microbrewery. And I'm not sure how this would work into your plan. Have you considered a reduction in that, or interfere with your...
You know, it all comes down to when I'm hoping for 76, but at the end of the day, when I get through with building, fire, they're the ones who are going to dictate how many seats I can put in there. And, you know, that's absolutely the max that I could possibly get in there. Okay? And most likely, just by design, and, you know, 76 is really going to be 66 probably by the end of the day. You know, and you know, eventually maybe we'll have some outdoor seating there off of it. I don't know. But, you know, I can't even get to that now because I can't.
Sure, I understand that. But I guess my question was, if there's a reduction in the number of seats, isn't there a corresponding reduction in the number of parking?
Yeah, and that's something we've discussed.
But it is. But it also, you know, it comes down to productivity. It comes down to, you know, revenue generation. And you know, if the revenue generation isn't there on a 76 seat, she can go right up at the end of the street and open a 50 seat at a lot less money and have no parking issues or no, mm-hmm. And whenever you develop in a downtown area, costs are always higher. It's more money. Because it just, people want to be there, but they have to have the revenue generation to be able to support it.
Sure, I understand that. My other question is, and I'm not sure that I know what your response is to Greg's suggestion that there be a temporary parking lot there. Is that something that you would consider?
I would definitely do it. The issue is kind of at the mercy of the Board of Selectmen. I've already sent them a letter requesting that, we sit down and talk about it, and they've denied the letter. And I sent them another letter telling them that you really can't deny it, and so I don't know where that's going. I haven't got a response back from them yet. So I would love to tell you, yeah, I'll put a temporary lot in there. I'd like to tell them I'll put a temporary lot in there, let me build this, and once we figure out where to put the rest of the parking, which I think we're adequate, I'll build the park then, but they're unwilling to sit with me right now.
So you're open to various solutions?
Absolutely.
And were you done? I mean,
yeah.
So the parking analysis you're talking about, is that sort of taking account the existing buildings,
yeah,
down square footage?
Yeah, everything. New buildings. Okay. It's done by the square footage. It's right. Actually done by actual count of people. We've actually gone to every single individual business and sat down with the hair salon and said, okay, can you show us your book? Show us who comes in at what time, how many clients you typically have. We did a study for the farmer's daughter for 3 months of what the churn is, how many seats we're churning. And just to let you know, from a restaurant that opens currently 6 days a week and is open from 7 in the morning till probably 2 in the afternoon, we try to shut the door then, our high is like 460 seats, meaning that we've turned on a Saturday or Sunday, okay? And there's still plenty of parking down there. In the middle is about 275 when you go Monday through Sunday. So it's we're already doing volume down there. All we're asking to be able to do is do that volume at night. And
the property that you own, you have 22 dedicated spaces.
Yep.
Is that correct?
Between properties they own,
between,
yes.
Between properties you own. And the issue is, some of those spaces are beyond 200 feet.
I think these ones are close, but I
believe them to be a little bit beyond, maybe like 25, 30
okay.
feet beyond.
Where are we at with that? I don't see a problem. I'm ready to move forward, but I just don't want to get in trouble. I don't want to do anything, that's against the bylaw, and we got that 200-foot limit. Now, does it go to ZBA if we approve it?
As chair, my hope had been to, knowing that we're waiting to hear from the AG, knowing that we'd like to see the traffic study they've been working on, the parking study, to start tonight and continue to our next meeting. That doesn't stop anybody from doing anything, but I think knowing that it's sort of at their own peril until we hear from the AG anyways, I think going one more meeting at least, would not anybody would do anything until then anyway, so.
But what it would allow me to do is to get permits. Okay, and you still have the authority to go back in an appeal period and it can be shut down then, and the permits can be revoked if that doesn't go through. If I don't start, I'm not gonna finish. And it's, I can't even begin to tell you how much pressure I'm getting from tenants that are like, all right, whatever, they're just.
Yeah, I understand, but this has been a big issue in town. This is an important issue for taking the kicking and screaming and controversy out of it. And we're talking about other possible solutions that we don't even have a plan for. So I think we need to, personally, I think we need to vet it a little more. I'd like to see, I wouldn't feel, I was doing my job responsibly if I decided on a parking application without having the parking study. I'm all for expediting things moving along. I think I've tried to make that clear here tonight. I've tried to communicate well and openly. But I don't think we would, I think.
With due respect, I understand where you're coming from, but, you know, pushing it to another meeting, it might be canceled because I might not have any tenants there. I know you're in a hard place, and I understand that, but I think the board should take a vote, and if they
Brian.
Deny it.
Brian, did you get that mic? Sorry.
Oh.
Did you give it to Dave?
Sorry, Wayne.
Oh. Just to clarify, so.
Use the mic.
Are there 22 spaces that are within 200 feet that you can dedicate right now?
These spaces right here, I would say they're probably at 240, maybe 230 feet.
So they're not within
nope.
200. So I'm just saying, isn't our bylaw that it's 200, it's not 2?
I agree. Could I just ask for a point of clarification? The difference between a dedicated space and a publicly available space.
Sure.
So I think I understand the definitions, but when the AG comes back and hopefully approves the bylaw change, we're allowed to reduce the required parking on the site to whatever number we see suitable.
Correct.
So we could say 7 spaces is adequate
if you
based on the knowledge that there are other public spaces available downtown.
Is that correct? You could do that.
Right. But so why are we searching for dedicated spaces then?
That's what the bylaw says. The bylaw says you have to have a certain number of dedicated spaces.
Currently the bylaw says that.
Well, and the bylaw will still say that. It'll just say you can reduce that number. It doesn't change the definition of dedicated. So to me, dedicated means these spaces are for this use. So somehow if those spaces are going to be used, which I think is, you know, I think you could show the board and all of us that. You have to kind of communicate that somehow, whether that be with signage or what, to make people know that this parking is for this use. Now, municipal parking, I think, is totally different. Municipal parking, as you said, can be used by anybody. So that's why those aren't counted towards dedicated spaces.
So can public parking be on private property, or does it have to be on municipal property?
Can public parking be on private property?
If a private entity makes their parking lot available to the public to
yes.
park in it, does that count as public parking, or is that still private parking?
It counts as public parking. It would be.
It's private parking on, but it would be if I'm leasing a spot of parking, I'm leasing it for my own
use.
So it wouldn't be public parking. It would be private parking. There's allotted to the facility that I'm saying the parking's going there.
Correct. So if with the temporary lot idea on the little park back there, all that parking or some of it, enough that the board felt comfortable, would be used only for these retail, or this restaurant and this microbrewery as a temporary means. Again, I think the town and Mr. Howe and everybody else downtown is looking for other solutions, including municipal parking, which again is a different thing, but I think that affords the board some flexibility in terms of being flexible and looking at the number of spaces required.
So I believe the Attorney General is next Tuesday or Wednesday. You're supposed to hear by, and then if you don't hear it, it's assumed approved.
That's correct. Well, the assumed approved part is correct. I'd have to check on the date, but I know it's coming up soon.
Okay, so my point is, if you took a vote on it today and you said, okay, I can definitely give you 8 spots back here, and you waive the rest, knowing how much municipal parking there is just for this, and it's predicated on the Attorney General coming and saying yes on Tuesday, Wednesday, whatever the date is, wouldn't that work?
Well, I think I'll jump in here. The problem with that, Dave, and we're trying to help you, I think I've demonstrated that. I've heard a number of different proposals here tonight. You were just mentioning valet parking. I don't think we have quite enough information yet, given the gravity of this. And, you know, we're talking 2 more weeks to our next meeting. And, you know, I think what you went to the trouble of doing a study. Well, we haven't had a chance to look at it and deliberate over it and digest it. why would you have done that, you know?
Hear me out.
And, you know, we can't take into account any parking spaces over 200 feet. Right now they have to go, unless we want to waive all parking. And taking all controversy and other matters out of it, I just don't think, I would like to see that parking study that you've preparing come in. If there's going to be a valet, this first I've heard of that, if that's gonna happen, because I have some issues with that. There's an intersection right there. We need to, you know, that's something that needs to be talked about and deliberated. We have no plan of that. I would like to, you know, I think this is a good start tonight. I would like to get the rest of the information that you've talked about getting here. I'd like my board to digest this is important. I'd like to hear from the public, and you know, we'll hear from them tonight, and then certainly be ready to I'd be much more comfortable voting 2 weeks from today than I would today, just because I don't think we have quite enough information. And frankly, I think that would be a yeoman's effort on our part. I think we've shown, you know, we're trying to work it, but you know, these are important, and I understand that. But you know, you told me you have a permit to work indoors, so you know, we're not,
it's,
you know.
I can't, you know.
Yeah, but, you know, I don't think our decision should be based on someone needing to get a building permit. I hear where you're coming from, but I just ask you to be just a little more patient. And I don't think that's unfair on my part. Of course, I'm just one of six, seven, however many we have. So, you know, if someone cares. So, why don't we, is there anybody in the audience that wants to, you know, we've been doing all the talking up here. If you just identify yourself for the record, grab the microphone or go up to the microphone.
Yeah. Thank you.
Frank Altieri, 10 Balsam Lane, about a 25-year resident of Easton. My kids all went through the school system, and I'm the one of the proprietors for the microbrewery. And you know, as Dave said, we've been waiting and waiting, and it's been difficult for us because we've secured financing that we needed to start off for our initial investment, and we're looking for time to revenue so we can get, you know, start paying back our loans and keep that cost down to start the business that we dreamed about. And another thing about the brewery business, we have to secure product or raw materials far in advance. We have to, hops are a very difficult commodity to manage, as well as grains. Grains are a little easier, but we're buying all of our grains and hops in Massachusetts. So we have to leverage contracts for that, and we have to put down money for that. So again, time to revenue for us is critical. That being said, I think the proposal of giving the approval to start based on the seven spots that appears to me to be within the bylaws that allow you to do that would be my recommendation for tonight. Thank you.
Anyone else in the public? All right. Oh.
Amy McManus, 51 Williams Street, Northeastern. I have a couple of questions. Forgive me. I haven't been following the plans for this particular property as much as I have for the 114 Main Street. Can you just point out for everybody where that park is? That's where you would put the temporary parking, am I right?
This is the park right here. Okay, this area right here. And that's all on private property other than that little piece right there.
Okay, and the park is why do we need another park?
Well, because when I initially put my bid together for 114, I was told that in the RFP that there was no on-site parking, but there would be municipal parking available and street municipal parking available.
Right.
So what I said is, well, geez, that makes sense. We start adding it up. Look at what was down there. I said, there was nothing there. I said, this would be a great place for people to walk up through here, through a park. It would access them to the back of the back. It would not be too intrusive to the neighbors where I could
put buffers of landscaping in and kind of shield the back of this.
Okay.
And that was the whole reason. Believe me, parks, it's a lot of money.
So that park belongs to you or to the town?
It belongs to me, but there's a piece of it on the town property that I have a lease for, and yeah, it belongs to me.
I'm just curious why the, I don't know what's going on.
I thought it would be great with the park, with the building.
Right.
And it would be, you know, there's a beautiful walkway going up. I just thought, you know, when you see any downtown area, you know, lots of times there's a nice park for people to congregate, whether they're sitting having a coffee,
right,
ice cream, and that was my thought. That's the
only. It sounds great. I'm just curious if now the parking is becoming such an issue with the various businesses, why can't you use that space for more parking?
It's up to the Board of Selectmen. I've asked them to meet with me, and they've rejected it.
How many spaces could you fit in that lot? And it's right behind the restaurant. Okay. And then the other question that I had was regarding the license agreement across the street. And actually, I'm pretty clear on that. But the idea for the additional parking for downtown Easton, going in where the park is, the Snellgrove Park, is the Snellgrove Foundation, are they agreeable to that?
Reach out to me.
Okay.
I'm trying to meet and get, you know, I'm just proposing it.
Okay.
You know, I would obviously have to go to them and you know, explain to them why, when, and how, and
okay,
all the particulars, and obviously if they said no.
Right.
It's.
But it would be moved. It would be moved to Pine Street? To Pine Street.
Yeah.
Okay.
We joined in, like, maybe that's the Snellgrove Playground here, and then the rest of the park would be potentially for another woman who was.
Right, I know, yeah, I know that story. So I don't know how that would go, but I just think in terms of a location for another park, since we have Frothingham and all these other parks, I would think that the Pine Street would make a lot of sense.
I just want to jump in because that's really not on the agenda for tonight.
Okay.
This is just an idea that a private citizen's proposing, has nothing to do with this board, so I think we should just keep that off.
All right. You know? Last question is did this whole entire process take place for the 114 Main Street?
Site plan?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So you were approved for the 114 Main Street and then denied when it went to ZBA, well.
What we did as a board.
Yeah, and rescinded.
We had a series of pre-meetings with town staff and the applicants and other town employees. We had, I believe, two public hearings at which, you know, we looked at it. We voted to approve. We had some conditions in there that we could circle back and readdress it if issues came up. It was, it wasn't continued, but we knew the selectmen. We couldn't give permission for valet parking or for the, as Dave said, part of that park is built on town land. So we can't approve someone to work on someone else's property, you know, without property owner's approval. So you had to get that from the selectmen. And then and then we knew it was going to the ZBA for.
I'm just curious parking, so. Why you would have a reservation about approving this with much less parking at stake or issues, potential issues, and not the 114 Main Street. How come the 114 Main Street went through this whole process?
Well, keep in mind, 114, the majority of the parking at 114 Main Street was in the King lot. And perhaps town council can give a little clarity on this, but as I understand, the reason it hit a glitch at ZBA was that it was a license versus a lease. The parking, in layman's terms, the parking could be lost. And, okay, now where are you going to put upwards of 100 cars? And so now, so I'm assuming that same issue exists with the Kingland. So we need to come up with 40, somewhere between 30 and 40 parking
but
spaces.
But it wasn't a concern.
40 parking. No, it was a concern, but that space is now gone. So see, you just lost the ability for 100 spaces. So now with that gone, okay, there's six spaces over here and the six spaces there, but people don't park like that. Are we gonna dot downtown? And I just, let me answer a question, Dave. You know, I want, as a planning representative of this town, I want parking that's going to work. So that, you know, that's on street, it's where it's obvious. It's where you can see. I don't think having a bunch of little six and four and three satellite parking lots, I don't think that's gonna work very well for a whole host of reasons. So, and here, you know, frankly, Amy, this is a big project, and I dare say I can't remember a time when a similar project would have gotten out of here in one meeting. I mean, we're doing, you know, we have a lot of responsibility here. We have a lot of work here. So
I understand that. That's not what I'm asking.
As I'm hearing it tonight, we don't even have all the information that we would base our decision on. So
right.
I don't feel, as the chair of this board, I don't feel they would be responsible for us to vote yet because we don't have all that information. So I don't think we'd be doing our job right for the people that we represent, the residents of Easton. I could be wrong. That's my opinion, you know.
And my last question is, and this isn't just for this board, it's for every board. You said it, that this should have been dealt with 2 years ago instead of 2 months ago. Why is this all, excuse my language, but hitting the fan now?
I think when you get that answer, you can come back and tell us all, because I think we'd all love to know.
If I could say one thing about that, I mean, I think in everybody's wildest dreams, you know, three restaurants downtown, that sounds great. But I think people foresaw that to happen over a period of time. When the selectmen were approving the sewer district and people were talking about downtown revitalization, I don't think people anticipated things to go that quickly.
So but why is that the developer's fault? I've been listening to the vision of downtown Easton for years.
Yeah.
And so regardless of what went downtown, there's no parking that goes with those buildings. And it really is frustrating for the community to have all of this happening at a time where the buildings have already been purchased, the work has already started. There's been so much wonderful renovation done downtown, and now all of a sudden everything seems to be coming to a screeching halt, and it's frustrating.
Well, I would point out this is the first public hearing tonight for this property, and I know you don't come to our meetings very often, but projects aren't approved in one night. We deal with many, many important issues. And you know, if you were signing a contract to build a house, or if you were before the town for a building permit. And you came in and you said, oh, yeah, well, I'm going to do all this other stuff, but it's not on the plans. You wouldn't get a permit. So we, you know, I want to make sure we have all the information that we can get so that we can make the best decision. And
I'm just asking questions, Greg. That's all I'm doing is asking questions.
And I'm just answering your question.
And I think a lot of people are frustrated over this, so I'm asking questions based on that frustration. And it's very difficult to have people keep telling you, well, you don't come to the meeting. So, you know, that's not everybody go. I go to as many meetings as I can.
Okay,
I'm asking questions. I'm asking questions,
that's it. That's really not what we're talking about here tonight. This is the first night we've had this property before us. Carol Nessler?
Carol Nessler, 37 Mechanic Street. I have actually two questions if you could address. One is the King license agreement, is that outside the 200 feet? Is that outside the distance? It is.
Well, outside, yeah.
Okay, and then just more for public information, can somebody explain, because we do have several businesses downtown that have virtually no dedicated parking, so I think that's one of the things that the public may be saying, how do we have all these other businesses, there's no dedicated parking, and why is it an issue now? So if somebody could explain how the other businesses that don't have dedicated parking, mm-hmm. are allowed to operate, it might be helpful.
Well, I would say a lot of them were approved before zoning, so that's the case in several businesses downtown, or the use, not the business itself, but the use.
Well, explain to me then the shop that turned into a, I don't know the name of it, Pixie Dust or.
Yeah. Was it a change of use? Doesn't it gonna be worse? It was a retail store, a change or a retail store?
But
pre-existing non-conforming.
So if I keep this as retail, if I keep that as retail, I have no issue.
That's why the farmers don't require parking, is because it was already a restaurant.
What's that? No, my question is, if I kept the church just as retail, then I wouldn't
So it wouldn't be an issue?
We have to look at it. It would have to be a case-by-case basis. If I look at the application, we take a look at it.
But there's no application if it's what I'm using it for, what it's always been.
If you're using it as for what it's always been, that's true.
Which is retail.
Which is a sheet music store. So, yeah, again, I
think
it would come to us for change of use. That's what, you know, like when you renovated.
I understand that, Greg, but my question then is, okay, you went from a hardware store to a furniture home goods store, okay? If me going
from microphone, I guess that's okay.
Me going from a store that sold out of there for years to just going retail there, how would that be any different?
That's not the application before us. You're proposing to go to a restaurant. It wouldn't be any different, but you're proposing to go to a restaurant, so that question's not germane to what we're here
It is. I'm just asking the question because the restaurant might be pie in the sky right now because it's you know.
But the application before us isn't pie. It says it's a restaurant. So that's why. If your application before us was for retail, I don't think it would be before us because I don't think it's a change.
That was just my question. That's all I was asking. I wasn't being argumentative. Right. I was just asking Gary if I stuck with retail there 100%.
Again, I'd have to look at the application, but I think
there would be no application though.
There'd be a building application. There'd be something to look at.
Okay.
So I'm just hesitant to tell you no.
I understand that. I'm just asking the question. Right.
I'm confused about one thing, and perhaps either Gary or Jay can answer the question. I'm going back to the proposal for temporary parking. I understand that originally the idea was a park, and now the whole original idea is on hold because 114 was not approved by ZBA. So what I'm trying to understand is what does it have to do with the Board of Selectmen, and why do they need permission from the board to do anything?
Sure. I think the general answer to that is because the Board of Selectmen agreed to sell that land to Mr. Howe under certain conditions in which he would do certain things. So I think that's the connection there.
Okay.
Now, whether or not it could be used for a temporary lot for this use, since it's on hold, I'd defer to Jay on that. I'm actually interested in that, the answer to that myself. Whether or not could the board look at a temporary lot on part of the rear of 114 as part of this application, or is that on hold now because that entire property is on hold?
Well, I'm not sure I would characterize anything as on hold or not on hold per se. There is an agreement
between the town and the developer that requires the development to follow
a certain design.
That would change the design. So the parties would have to get together. There's some preconditions on it. I don't think it's fruitful for myself to go
into that and where that is, nor do I think I could, given the nature of those
discussions. But it is complicated. It is possible, but again,
temporary parking runs out just the same as licensed parking. So it kind of restarts the clock on that a little bit too. It could be a great solution. It could be a temporary fix. It could be a terrible solution, but it hasn't been, to borrow a phrase from your chairman, it hasn't been vetted yet. And it's premature right now for us to vet it.
Thank you.
In the proposal there is based on me being able to receive permits to build a restaurant, which I propose, which has been rejected by the ZBA.
Just your everyday site meeting. So, anybody else before we... All right. So, you know, I guess our options are, you know, you've heard what I've recommended, to continue to our next meeting so that we could digest this and we could, you know, get parking analysis that you're working on. Or, you know, someone, you can always make a motion, but I think we do a frankly a great job at this board in moving things along. You don't often hear complaints, or at least I don't, maybe people say it behind my back. You don't hear complaints about this board. I think we're open and fair and we're pretty quick. And I personally would just, I'd like to get that parking analysis, and I'd like to let my board digest this. I think we could, and again, I don't know if we really could get a building permit until AG does something, but that's, we don't need to discuss it. It doesn't matter, we're not lawyers. So, at the board's whim, what say ye?
I think continuing to another meeting is the best option at this point. I mean, I know we risk, slowing down your business, but we also have the other considerations, and I don't feel two meetings for a restaurant with a lot of vehicles going up and down is asking too much. I don't know. I can't say it's going to end in two meetings, but I don't feel like one more meeting. In general, it's not usually a deal breaker as far as, we're concerned with. So, but.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Can we get the mic
so you can hear me? Oh, microphone. Sorry, I'm
no
just
one
keep saying that.
You don't have the mic.
If you are going to continue, is there, like a set criteria or information that you're going to need so that when we do come to the next meeting, we can get a decision, or hopefully get a decision?
Well, I'm never going to promise you're going to get a decision at the next meeting because I'm not clairvoyant. But I think I've made it clear that we're expecting to hear the parking analysis or study, whatever you're titled, that is going to be done by Thursday or something. So I think that's
but
all.
Most likely we'll have to review by a consultant.
And the parking plan that was shown tonight, obviously the board wants to see that.
I'm actually
seeing that in advance of the meeting, so.
In terms of, this, I'm not, I've gone on the record and, I don't necessarily feel we're going to need to wait on peer review. I did pretty good in my math SATs. I think we can figure out parking spaces. I just think we need to look at square footage, because you do have to think worst case. You talk about, well, this business has these hours, but things could change. The use of your buildings could change. So, I just want us to make a decision with as much information as we can have. So, I'd beat a dead horse on that, I think. So.
One question. Just as far as the approval and making sure that it works with your finances and everything, the parking needs to be, it's either going to be yes or no. It's not like it can't be a, obviously the temporary parking, the 1 year thing, next door.
When I talk to time to revenue, it means that, we are anticipating a build out and, getting our materials in.
I understand that, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, as soon as we get the decision, then we can move forward. We don't have to have everything in place, but at least so we can see that we can progress, we can get our materials on order, we can start bringing in equipment, that kind of thing.
What about the temporary or not temporary parking you're showing? Whoever is going to work with this on you, are they okay with temporary parking and then you figure out a way to get permanent parking eventually?
I'm okay with temporary parking.
I believe
there's plenty of parking.
I think someone who at least I think is pretty smart wrote something to that effect. I just wanted to see where that we fell along that
line.
To
be honest with you, what I feel is that the seven spaces that are already there, I think you guys can approve once you get the AGs. My nirvana for me would be you approving it based on those seven spaces that exist and dependent on the AG's approval. So that would be the motion that I'd like to see tonight, to be honest with you. Okay.
And just understanding that, he's not the major tenant. And without the major tenant, it makes it very difficult to go forward with anything there.
Just to clarify, Greg, so even when we get the parking study that you're doing, the temporary parking that you have requested the Board of Selectmen discuss, that's really not necessarily going to be...
Let me clarify.
Yeah.
I brought up an idea of temporary parking because, again, first of all, we don't know what the AG is going to do. And, so do we want to... you know, we would have to approve, we would have to waive all required parking save the seven spaces. Because anything outside of, if we didn't do that, and then anything outside of 200 feet would have to go before ZBA. So with a nod to, not trying to keep it from ZBA, but trying to, you know, eliminate an unnecessary step, analyze the parking here as the town approved at this year's town meeting, and move forward. So thought was, well, if we, when Mr. Howe comes and presents us with this parking plan, if as we analyze it, if we look and say, you know, I think we're going to need, you know, more than seven spaces, you know, and again, you know, wink, wink, we know there's spaces in the street and around the corner, but, you know, then we could say, okay, we would, you know, if a potential solution was, that's why I brought that up tonight, within 200 feet, again, would expedite the process. If we determine it was necessary, the potential to have a temporary parking lot where that park is, because it was within 200 feet. You know, what if we determine, you know what, we think they need X spaces, some number more than seven. Well, where are we going to create it? This is the only place I could think of that has any within 200 feet. So that's what that whole idea came up from. Mr. Howe wasn't proposing it. We brought it up tonight. We asked him. Again, as we go through the planning process here, we're trying to figure out. And if we choose that way, then, you know, hopefully we could come up with a way and, you know, to... because clearly he's not going to come in with an engineered site plan for parking that would have to go through... That would have to go through some peer review for, you know, drainage, etc. But, you know, maybe there's a way we could work around that. Don't know, but, you know, something.
Isn't that land sort of, as you, town council said, it's complicated. So isn't it really just not even?
It's not realistic.
Potentially up for discussion next time either. So we're really talking about whether or not seven spaces may or may not be adequate, based on whatever information we might get from Mr. Howe's parking study.
Sure, you can look at it that way.
I think that's correct.
Yeah.
I think that's exactly what we're
right. And can we legally, like, I'm just not.
Yeah, let me just interject. Okay. I just want to interject. So, because I don't expect some magic wand to be waved and Mr. Howe is suddenly going to come up with the plan. But maybe, you know, he has several months of construction to go to get this place up and running. So I assume that's how long it would take to do a parking lot out there. So, you know, through this, he's brainstorming, talking about an idea across the street, which seems to be a long shot. Not a bad idea, perhaps, but you know, there's nothing here. We're all working together as a community to try and come up with a solution that works. Because for all the people that sit here and say, why are you slowing things up? Let it be done. Well, you know what? When you can't move on Main Street, when someone can't find any parking, and the first person that gets hit, you know, because there's traffic everywhere, you know, they're going to come back and there's going to be an issue too. So, you know, we can't be derelict of our duties. We still have to go through ours. And I refuse to, be painted with being obstructionist or not being helpful because we want to prove it in one meeting where we don't have all the information. I just think that's foolish on our part.
And Greg, yeah, absolutely no disrespect, but there is 146 municipal spots that aren't used that night because there's nothing open down there. Okay, and that's all. You guys got to vote on what's the, or postpone it to when you want, but there's 146 spaces available right now, and I'll tell me what business stays open after 5-6 o'clock down there. There's nothing.
But Dave, then why did you go to all the trouble to create a study to present? I mean,
the study wasn't necessary for you guys.
But forgive us. We're the planning board. We would actually like to see the study about parking on a building that you're asking us to reduce the parking by about 80%. Okay, so let's be done with that. That's not going to go any further. Okay.
You know what? Just withdraw the whole thing. I'm just going to sell it.
I can't do that. That's not my. So does anybody want to make a motion to continue?
No, I don't want to continue. I'm pulling the permit.
I would just proceed until.
No, okay. I'm telling you, I'm the applicant. Pull the permit. That's it. Done. Solve the problems. Done. Done with you and the rest of them.
So under site plan review. Mm-hmm. We can still continue. It's just an open application.
I think you can continue.
I'm telling you, I'm the applicant. Hold it.
Yeah, but I don't think the procedure is to do it here.
Greg, I'm telling you here, do it.
Okay.
I'm done.
Yeah.
So
Mr. Howe.
I say to continue.
Could you come back in?
No continuation.
Can we
continue to
allow the withdrawal?
No continuation. It's a withdrawal.
So I'm sorry,
I hear you.
Allow him to withdraw? Okay. So do we need to make a motion?
You do.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can do what you want. There's
no, it's
a making a motion that they're accepting your withdrawal, sir.
Okay, good.
As long as someone makes the motion.
I think there's a resolution here. I think if
people,
if you sit down and we talk about this, I think we can come to a resolution, Mr. Howe.
The resolution is voting on what's right. There's 146 municipal parking spots here, okay? That's more than enough parking, okay? And forget about the other stuff that may or may not happen down there. There's 146 spots, more than ample parking. Common sense tells you.
But Dave, look at it. Do me a favor. Please, we go back a long way as residents. And I understand you've been through a lot on this. And, you know, we worked all together as a board with you, I thought, on this. I don't think asking for two more weeks.
Right.
But you know what? Just continue it now. You can always withdraw tomorrow morning or next week.
Dave, your passion and drive is really admirable. And the reason... I can tell how much passion drive you.
The ZBA beat me. He beat me. It's done. I'm selling them.
So work with
you're
us.
You're this close,
work
though,
us.
Dave.
No. I'd rather have Solomon do it.
David, I think
what?
Working with us is your best way to get through.
I'm not waiting 2 weeks. I'm not waiting 2 weeks.
All right. I'd like
see.
To say, I'm going to request a 5-minute recess.
Okay.
At the behest of Christine. Wayne, can you give us 5 minutes?
Okay.
Thank you.
that's going to improve. I'm done. I'm done. No, I'm good. I'm good. Oh, Dave said yeah. Sorry. Why can't I open anything on this tonight? I don't know. I'm in the wrong place. You guys, go ahead and do what you want to do. If you,
great. You could still move to continue.
These guys are going to make a motion to approve. You want to approve it? Oh, well, okay. It's all good.
No, hold on.
Well, you can do whatever you guys want. I'm going to leave it to you guys.
One,
if you think I was wrong.
Wonderful. We're on the air. We're on the air.
Good. We're on the air. What joy. Welcome back, everybody. Hope you had a nice chance to get some popcorn. So, anyways. So my board members, I think we need a motion of some type.
Mr. Chairman, I believe we have a motion already by Peter to continue. And
hold on.
No, it was a discussion. No.
I thought you made a motion
to
continue.
He didn't.
Then I'm going to make a motion to continue this meeting for 2 weeks. And what I would like to hear from the applicant, should he decide to continue, and I strongly, strongly encourage him to continue, is I would like to see a parking plan. I would like to see a parking plan that shows his additional spaces that he has downtown. And
you need to get into the details.
Say that again?
I think you just make a motion to continue. That's fine.
And
that's what you want.
And we have that. We're good.
I'll second that. And I have just one idea to throw out there is that since there are some sort of spots around, maybe there's a possibility that some other spots could become a certain amount of dedicated spots for open-ended.
I think let's just make it a motion to continue. I think we're getting in the areas that are beyond. So just for clarity, the motion is to continue the meeting to our next
meeting on August 24th.
On August 24th. Is there a second? Well, there was a second.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. Any further discussion?
Long-winded second.
Hearing none, all those in favor? Mm-hmm. All right, let's continue. It's like, all righty. So let's see. Next, let's see. Basic commercial design. Do you want to do the minutes next?
Is there something else on the
sure. Camera? Let's skip that second bullet point.
They made a copy. Here they are. Take a break here in the minutes.
Yeah, let's do the minutes, then we'll all do right. The request for comments.
Guys, I already read these online.
Very good, Peter.
Yeah. No one cares. Yeah.
Some of them are not stapled, it looks like. Yeah. Two? There's two, isn't there? There's
just one? Two packages?
Is there 2 minutes or just 1 minute? Mm.
There's just one set of minutes.
One set.
July 20th.
Thank you.
It appears to be lengthy. Thank you, Pam. It's not your fault. Did it accurately, obviously. I meant thank you when I said thank you.
It's different ideas. Mm-hmm. Oh. So this is no different than what was online, right?
This is the same thing that was online, yes.
Yeah so I didn't have any changes.
I was wondering if just on page 2 when you talked about the state 40R programs, you kind of, I think you mentioned kind of a little more detail about it so people just didn't think it was a 40R as what they know about 40Rs.
Oh, you mean the name?
Yeah, how it's compact housing. I think okay. You mentioned something like 40R compact housing, something to that effect.
So, yeah, all right, so that's a good point. So if we could say Mr. Strange talked about the state compact neighborhood program, you know. Which is a 40R program. Understand that, Pat?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody else?
I'm good, Chairman. Make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of July 20th.
Second, with the changes.
All those in favor? Motion passes. Thank you. Okay, why don't we do ZBA request for comment, variance number 1514, which...
Let's see here. Let me make sure I get the right one.
I seem to be totally...
Oh, that's the wrong one.
Request for comment.
It's one of the requests for comments. 1514,
it's the...
Columbus. Right?
If you go, go to
My files, right?
Oh, yeah. I was gonna say go to.
One was Lincoln, one's Columbus.
It doesn't.
This is Columbus.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. There you go. So doesn't open.
I haven't tried the minute. Nothing else would, but maybe.
I've got it here if you need it.
Get it, Craig?
No, nothing will open on this tonight.
For some reason.
But that's okay. I read it at home. All right. So.
This is the garage?
This is the garage.
Right. Anybody, Gary, you have anything on this, or?
No, not on this.
This neighbor of mine, I do not know them. I didn't realize this was even up.
You need to get up for it.
I should.
David, I have to say, your roof looks pretty good from Google, from the street view. I like the
yeah.
They have an interesting look.
But,
this is the,
I'm being in the location where it's at.
Oh, yeah.
I have no problems with it's not getting any worse.
So which side are you on? I guess my only
across the street and four doors down.
My only comment would be I think that the proposed building, they don't talk about the height of the proposed garage, and this existing shed garage building is fairly low. And I guess the question would be if they would be subject, I assume they would be subject to the height restrictions in the zoning bylaw.
Yeah, so, I mean, because the variance is just for the
not it's for just height. For the footprint, right? So the footprint. So the height would be, because I think...
You can make
what is the minimum? What is the minimum, I should know this, but what is the minimum height for the offset for the existing building? In other words, I know it steps back as we get closer to the property line.
It's an average height of 25 feet, average, average of the roof plus the wall height, 25 feet at 15 feet, the side setback we're talking about, right?
Right.
And then every foot you infringe within that, the height comes down a foot. So
it's 13, so they're infringing 13 feet.
So on the height would come down to 12 feet. So that would be...
And
that's only the
So I guess my question was, would it be functional as a garage and at 12 feet? I think it would be.
Yeah, because what happens is when you, and we've had this a few times, and again, it's the average height of just that, it's just the portion that's within that.
Right, so I guess that was my concern because it was so close, but at 12 feet, that would work, so.
Yeah, and I'm assuming, I mean, they didn't include it, but there must be something designed because they're not going for a height variance, you know?
Unless they don't know, right.
And they may not.
May not.
Well, we could just make a note in our. I mean, it would come up at ZBA, I'm assuming, right? You know, but we could make a note.
We could just say that maximum height.
Mary always reads what we write, so you know, we could just, as we have in the past, we could just make a note.
So, you looking for a motion?
Yes.
Motion to record.
Sorry.
Sorry. Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask.
Okay, holding the microphone.
Sorry, I just wanted to ask. If we, you know, I think a wraparound porch seems like a... we're doing the other one. Okay.
Yeah, doing the
okay. Strike that.
Okay. So, motion to recommend the application 1514, noting that maximum height at 2 feet from the property line would be 12 feet in height.
Second.
Any further discussions?
Request for comment.
Hearing none, all those in favor? Boom.
Oh.
And that's
yeah.
special. Now, special permit and variance are the same.
That was for a variance. No, it's a different project.
All right, so 15 is the wraparound porch.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Just say 15.
Yeah. Right, so the next one.
Which, and what's the address? If y'all don't
153 Main Street.
Where's 153 Main at?
Seems pretty reasonable to me.
If you don't mind.
Go ahead.
Wow, we actually got plans.
Wow.
That's a change.
Looks like something photocopied out of a book, maybe. But.
Oh. That was Wayne Benson.
Where's 153 Main?
Mm. It's right on the corner, right on the corner of Williams and Main. up in the hill there.
You want to stay for the variance?
This is the skunk at the garden party.
They put in a bunch of windows last year, didn't they?
Yeah, yeah. This they put in pillows. Yeah.
So
with the prairie style.
Prairie style.
Yeah.
Comments? Anybody?
Looks fine to me.
Any motion for a recommendation?
Motion to recommend.
Second.
Yep.
Panel, I'll let you decide.
Well, I was just going to say, were they, I just can't tell from here, are they actually extending the footprint?
No, I think the house is staying the same.
So. Yes, they're extending the footprint.
So it's, they're increasing the side porch part of it.
Yeah, right now it's just in the front, they're running it down the side.
Variance request.
So my question was going to be, without having a very precise historically accurate memory for what would be appropriate for this type of house. And I'm not saying that a wraparound porch would not be attractive. I'm just saying, does that variation, is it not in keeping with homes that would normally only have a porch? I'm just saying, like, by allowing it, are we kind of adding a...
I don't know about the styles, but I know that farther east along Main Street on the left, there are some larger porches, but that might be a different...
The house right next door has a wraparound porch that goes the opposite direction.
And is it
direction.
A similar age and style?
Yeah, it's 18. I mean, they call it a Victorian. Of course, they put prairie-style windows in it, which makes you scratch your head a little bit, but it is, you know...
I know we don't have guidelines or anything at this point.
I think that's the historic commission.
Yeah. We really the variance is for the increase of the footprint. They're increasing the nonconformity. That's what we're ruling on. We can't get into architectural details. It's not in our bylaws. It's irrelevant in this case.
No, but I mean we should be thoughtful of by increasing the footprint what the possible repercussions may or
right,
may not
but I think
be,
you
and
have
I'm
to
not
th- but I think you'd have to look at it from a scale standpoint, not an architectural detail standpoint. That's my only point.
Well, even from a massing standpoint, I think you could look at it from
massing scale.
Yeah.
That's the same.
Yeah,
that's the same thing.
So does that mean the Historical Commission actually does have a say in this after if this
I would
is
think
approved?
They would.
I have to look at the map. The
It's inside.
No, this
property is inside the district.
The corner of Williams and Main Street?
Yes, it is.
Oh, yeah.
I think it would be, right?
Yeah. They would have a say.
Okay.
I
checked the map.
I'm a little off right now, if you don't mind.
A map of the historic district is coming up later, so.
Right, it's there. It's
all right, So, I would note that.
So I'll change my motion to include a note to make sure to check with the Historical Commission.
Yeah, that's actually a really good
one. Okay.
In fact, I'd like to, we should add to that the, hopefully that really the historical district should be, almost should have gone to them. I'm thinking a lot of them, but I'm wondering if it should have gone to them first.
You mean first?
You're right, it would still go to ZBA first, because they have to have the right to build the space. And then, make a point. Add on that, right, they have to, prior to getting a building permit, they have to receive approval from the Easton Historical Commission.
What does the filing with the Historical Commission cost?
What's it cost?
Yeah, how much does it file? Because I know it costs, $1,000 or $2,000 for a variance. Right?
It's not that.
It would actually be easier to go the other way, but yeah.
It's less.
Yeah.
So did you get that, Pam?
Is that a motion?
I think we had a second, right?
So I amended my motion to recommend, but make sure that they...
You're not going to be watching this TV one. This will be getting played on ECAT. All right, any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Thank you. No idea what this computer is doing at this point.
That was an easy one.
All right, so we have Quesic Commercial District Design Guidelines, Downtown Zoning Discussion.
Which would you like to do?
What do you want to do first, guys?
We might as well talk about downtown since we're already knee-deep in it. Mm-hmm.
Since we're on it. Okay. So at the last meeting, the board started talking a little bit about what a downtown zoning district could look like. I sent some information via email, included some information that the board asked or requested to see last time for some other surrounding towns, and also some, there was a template that the state provided. I don't know if anybody had a chance to look at that, but one of those ideas was to actually make it an overlay district, so that might be something that the board wants to consider. In an overlay district, you could still utilize the underlying district, but anybody could choose to use the overlay if they so chose, so that's something to think about. Here's the current zoning downtown. You'll see the yellow again is business zone all along Main Street there. Pink is industrial, which is strangely still the zoning for Ames Shovel Works. The green hatch is municipal urban space. I redid this chart here, of course, not very big, but hopefully you can see most of it, but this shows the dimensional requirements for various towns. We went over this last time, and again, the main points here are Easton is really the only town that I looked at that includes the general business district for its downtown. Most other towns, including I added Sandwich and Lexington there, as a couple people suggested, either have no lot size requirements or a much smaller one. Sandwich has a 20,000 one. Almost all the others have no lot size requirements. Most have either no frontage or very small frontage. Height, actually, we're on the higher side of allowable in the downtown, which I found interesting. And max lot coverage, again, most towns either don't have one or it's very high, 85 or 90%. Of course, the other discussion that we enjoyed this evening was about parking. And right now, or once the AG chimes in, basically in any business district, the planning board can reduce at its discretion. But other towns have different ways of looking at parking. Some allow you to count municipal spaces. Most, if they include a distance that we talked about tonight, 200 feet from a certain property, most of those distances are larger, either 300 or 500 feet, which seems to be fairly practical. There's discussion tonight about dedicated spaces, and some of these towns start to get away from that or allow you to count other spaces, again, at the board's discretion or via the special permit process. Let's see. I can come back to this, but let me just go to the last slide and then I'll see what the board wants to talk about. This is just a last slide. I overlaid there the Ames Local Historic District. So the shaded portions, the light, very light blue, faded blue, are properties within the Ames Local Historic District. And then that blue outline was just sort of a first guess of the area that you might want to look at. Again, it's just for discussion purposes. It goes as far as the corner of William Street to the, east? And doesn't go down towards Pond Street. A lot of those larger homes that are actually zoned business there. I think if I got the discussion right from last time, the board was sort of hesitant to go down that far. Possibly, maybe some of those properties would be at risk if you allowed more development on those lots, and that's sort of a different character than the actual core of the downtown, which is between, William Street and the Rockery, I guess. So again, this is sort of my thoughts on the next steps, but again, I want to hear what the board thinks about both the location of a potential district. This included Center Street on there. I'm not sure if that's something we want to do or not. And the details of the dimensional requirements and other issues.
So just refer, did you say if you have an overlay district that, if, or if your property is in an overlay district, you can basically choose to either do the overlay or the underlay?
Correct. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't we have the same, I mean, wouldn't the same thought process for the houses that are outside of the district on Main Street apply to the houses on Center Street, or is there a reason why we would treat them differently?
There, again, there's no reason. This is just my first sort of take on it. So,
Well, I mean, there's some businesses, there are some businesses that exist. There's obviously the funeral home and the other things. I'm just...
I think there's generally, I mean, if you look at the buildings, they're up closer to the street already. They might not take up as much of the lot. I think on Main Street, they're pushed back just a little bit more. That's a little bit hard to see, but again, I'm not married to either one.
I think having an intersection, where the
difference promotes commercial growth. Yeah, that makes sense.
Rather than just a linear.
Yeah,
Peter brought up a question last time. Would you be able to, like, say, develop right in front of the Easton Grammar School?
With the zero.
You can't do that because of, well, you have to go through the Historical Commission, which would be very challenging, I'm imagining, right, because it's in the Ames Local Historic District. Mm-hmm.
Right.
So that kind
of...
Yeah,
I have to thought about that later, right? Yeah.
Right.
So, I guess our thought would be... Like you said, two sub-districts, I guess, right?
It could be.
I mean, you know, I'm just like thinking, like we talked about last time, how, you know, on Main Street, you know, you have, you know, the furthest to the north, where would you start? You know, 68 Main Street, which is the old bank. Just say starting with that one, maybe past it, but I'm trying to think. Those are, you know, but you have a series of buildings that have pretty much zero lot line, you know, at least with the street, right? Don't have little to no parking.
Coming like that way from the east, you're talking about?
Yeah, like if...
Sorry, I don't have a cursor.
It's good to stretch. So like, if I may. So here is, so that's like 68, right? Here's Oak Sam, so yeah. 68. So sort of this block, you know, I know Sundell's is a little different, you know, but... You know, certainly, you think of these, certainly, you know, kind of the properties we're talking about tonight.
Yeah.
And I don't know, these are houses, so I don't know, but at least these, right?
Mm-hmm.
To me, that's, would be one.
Kind of the same.
Sub-district, you know, call it, you know, village business or whatever, just something, you know, again, because it has zero lot line and, like, you think further down to, like, where Vertex is, Vertex?
Yeah.
That you wouldn't, you know, if we're going to redo the zoning, right, you wouldn't want the same zoning constraints or requirements on that property as you would say for downtown, because that is more,
yep,
has a larger lot, you know, 20,000 square feet,
right,
or whatever, 10,000, you know, versus, you know, it has, I mean, it's almost more like a residential lot because clearly it was a house originally.
So what you're saying is you'd like to look at rezoning that area too?
Well, I think we should, I mean, downtown we should rezone. We know that. We and my thought would be, so that would have, you know, I think we, you know, we talked about this previously, how we should just take a look and say, okay, is it, I guess it's probably zero setback required in the front because they're all, they're there. I mean, if they were to take down a building, we wouldn't get anything out of making them push the building back. They don't have the room to do it. Same for the setbacks, side setbacks, because they're abutting or there's a small alley between some.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so whatever, just by looking at it, analyzing, we'd come up with the dimensional requirements.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess it would probably, you know, go down towards, you know, we'd go to William Street, we'd probably grab that.
The corner there?
The corner is tough on William Street because it had three buildings on it, but let's say that if that ever got subdivided and that building that's right on the corner, put that on its own, you know.
But yeah, if you include that and you have very small frontages, then that would solve that problem.
Yeah.
Somebody could split it up very easily.
Yeah. I mean, even... So what we've been talking about, so the buildings, you know, downtown, you know, you hear talk about six or seven variances, but, you know, so many of them are really just,
right,
just administrative because, yeah.
I would like to see that same village zoning come come down Center Street, at least on this.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
All the ones on the right side, they're right at the street.
Yeah. No, you're right. Yeah, you go to like at least the hardware store, right?
This goes to the funeral home, which is where the current business zone goes to.
Yeah, I guess.
I think
creating.
I'm looking at the wrong street. I agree. Would you do it across? Yeah, I guess across the street.
I guess. I mean, you have that newer Humphreys building there that's set back.
Yeah. Well, no, you'd probably do it at, you do it, maybe you do it for the dry cleaners, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that one's easy.
I mean, it's also okay if it's set back now because you're just saying, you know, there's no max.
But the house on the corner of Oakland and Center doesn't have anything to do with that kind of style at this point. That's one of the big ones, right?
Yeah, that's
just right. No, that's
it doesn't have anything to do with
that. And again, we're thinking, and that's residential
right
at that point. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I know a couple of these are kind of.
Yeah, then you could actually put a pretty big building right on the corner of a residential, you know, kind of residential streets.
Right.
All right.
Yeah.
So on the west side of Center, bring it up a little bit.
You might want to come up a lot or two. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then the other one. So there's the. Well, there's obviously cleaners, and then
there's Humphreys,
right?
Yeah. Well, there's that house that's
yeah. Then there's
there.
A condo is up the hill, right? Yeah. I think you might just want to end it. Oh,
that's
end it at the condos up the hill almost. But
end it at the condos.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because then you have.
And it include the condos?
Gurney's old house.
Well, this up the hill, you could include them, right? Yeah, I mean.
Okay.
They're just.
And again, this will be vetted by the public and everything. Just for the next.
Changes there too.
So then what if people ask, why not go from William Street, extend farther down past the church to the, you know, there's some, it's kind of housey and kind of apartment-y going on down that way towards the old bank.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess they kind of match the other side.
On William Street?
No, if you're farther east on Main Street, on the church side, I think we just better to leave it that as it is.
I mean, the church, the rectory, and then there's a house with an office.
Yeah, there's a few houses.
A home office thing in the back there.
If you look at the satellite right on your screen, it really looks pretty good.
It looks like, does that line go through the Learning Cottage, or does it include the Learning Cottage across
the intent was to include it. So,
That lot probably should be included because there's no parking on that lot. And for anything to be, the parking is.
And it's currently zoned industrial, which is ridiculous. So that pink is industrial. So
yeah.
So I'd change
it. But it should probably include that site.
Yeah.
Why does that never change? They just wanted, it was a 40B, so they didn't have to worry about it.
They didn't care.
Put it up to town meeting, I guess, right?
And now they probably wouldn't let you. Financing would probably say, we don't want to deal with that or something. I don't know.
Should we
go back to the parking?
Should we change the other small buildings that are industrial, though? The non shovel work? You know, like the.
Which ones?
It's the Learning Cottage and the college. Is the phone?
Yeah, the phone and the Learning Cottage are both in. That's where the line is.
In the back side of Sindel's.
I mean, what if someone wanted to put an industrial use? Well, it's a local historic district, though, so it's covered. All right, it's just thinking aloud.
Dave wanted to see the parking. You want to see the note parking notes?
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
All right. You want me to read them? Is that helpful?
Yeah. Read them.
Okay. And these are just highlights, so you know, there are things that I found that allowed some flexibility or changes.
Whenever there was a distance, what was that distance? Was it typically more than there were 200?
The ones I saw were more. There were 500 or 300. I don't note them all here, but most of the ones I saw were more than 200. And that seems to make sense to me when I was looking at what's, let's say 200 feet within 140 Main Street, it's really not very much.
No.
Certainly people would, in a downtown area, walk 300 to 500 feet. I think that's reasonable.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have, as a board, have a right to, we can't change that, can we? Or accept a different number?
No, not currently. Currently, anything outside 200, anything off-site, altogether has to go to the ZBA. So in this district, you could change that if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
When we did our site walk, and we walked out to the current playground, and mm-hmm. we're talking about parking,
yeah.
that's more than 500 feet, isn't
that's
it?
That's a little more than 500 feet, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So how does that play into anything?
Again, yeah, your plan you did was 500 feet?
Yeah, we were outside of that. That was...
It was more like 600 feet?
Yeah, I know.
I mean, if that proposal ever had legs and came to fruition, I'm imagining that would be municipal parking, and that, to me, that's a different animal. That's, you know, we're trying to get some municipal parking.
You could live based on municipal
right,
parking.
Right, but yeah. That would allow the board some flexibility to, you know, waive things even more than perhaps you'd allow through the zone, to me. But unless it was parking for that building there, I mean, that would, obviously, but that's on the same site, or it would be, I guess, if you included it. Yeah, I'm talking about King's building.
So, whatever we would decide about parking, we have to take that into consideration with that location of that piece of property.
Yeah. Even though you're saying it would...
Whether it's municipal or not, we have to say something about it.
Some towns do. Some towns say you can count a certain number of municipal spaces.
So if you can count them, it's not an issue if it was municipal, correct?
Correct. If you could count them.
Does the municipal have to be within a certain distance or no?
Some of them do, some of them don't. So, I mean, it's a fair question. I mean, maybe we should just kind of try to start and look at what a reasonable requirement would be, and then see.
Those are starting up.
Because whatever that distance is, that's a reasonable amount. I mean, that's not very far.
It's a reasonable walk. I think most things in downtown are within 500 feet or of some place that people want to go to.
Mm-hmm.
Not every place that people want to go to, but
no.
Like that lot's not within 500 feet of the building we're talking about tonight.
Right. So that's what I'm thinking, that even though that's a reasonable walk.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you could have no number, too. You could say, we'll look at spaces that are in the downtown area or within this zone.
I mean, okay.
I think that makes sense. I think you have to look at downtowns differently than you look at the other parking requirements. It's more fluid, and you have to use some kind of logical judgment on it.
Yeah, I think that's right, because for some people 200 feet is too far, but
that's why I was asking about the accessible spaces, right? Because I feel that's the important requirement. Yeah, and I think to me that's what I would like to see is some accessible spaces for the people that can't walk that far.
Right. Should it be the town's responsibility to provide the accessible spaces in downtown? Because if we require each individual business to provide accessible spaces, they're going to be behind it.
Right. Yeah, I think it almost has to be the town. Because
they have to get a waiver, right?
By ABA, they have to provide them anyways. They have to provide a certain percentage of accessible spaces. So,
right.
Well, they'll just get a waiver because they'll say they don't have any parking space to begin with. And
Well, we were talking about the town or the private or the private applicant.
Oh, right. Yeah.
The town needs to provide them first.
We removed the requirement that the business required that.
I don't think we can't do that.
They have to provide a certain number based on the
percentage of parking spots. At least one of those.
If he's got seven parking spots, one of those needs to be accessible.
Right, would make sense anyways. So that's not really.
But was it your question, like, if we were to have the ability to reduce it to zero, then what happens? Who's responsible?
Then
for
he doesn't have a responsibility. But if he's building them out anyways, then he's. Even if our requirement is zero, he'd still, by ADA, have to put an accessible space.
Other cities, they make sure to put plenty of accessible spots along the road so that people can find them if they need them.
I just didn't know what would happen if it went down to zero, but there's an obligation anyway.
If he has the spots there, then he has to make it accessible.
What if there are no spots?
If there are no spots, then he... Well, I'm not an expert, but I would say no.
It's pretty easy to get a waiver for if you don't have any parking spots to begin with, I guess.
But that doesn't certainly meet our obligation to...
No.
Well, then you have to assume that there's municipal parking available and that the municipality is provided.
I would have to make them leave enough space on the lot for an accessible parking spot rather than using the entire footprint. But
yeah.
Well, I think the one thing that, since we're a suburban community too, we don't really have any, we don't have any public transportation, or even smaller towns, you know, have like a jitney or something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know, as the town develops or, you know, I'm not sure what we imagine, but I'm just saying, I think it's more feasible to have zero spaces if there's some other
options.
Yeah.
Yeah. And of course, this would be an easier exercise if we had a bigger municipal lot right now. We're trying to project and trying to, you know, trying to get
same thing they said 50 years ago, if we just had parking.
Because you know, I was looking at some of the presentation earlier tonight, and it's like, you know, our current zoning, you know, children's museum, it works out to 11 spaces.
Right.
You know, yeah. There's 22 yeah. always parked on Sullivan Ave, plus half the, you know.
Our parking requirements are not tough. Is it no, one out no. of every.
Even like the restaurants, yeah. 1 and 4, I've always that's, thought, that's what other towns do? 1 and 2?
1 and 2, 1 and 3.
Because who knows, when's the last time you went to dinner with 4 people?
Right.
You know, you're all happen. In the same car.
Yeah.
Right? That's you know, it's like.
That's just a family, you know.
Yeah. Oh, exactly. Yeah. You know, it's
really not asking a lot, so.
So is the end game here, do we think that, you know, right now we have one business owner. I mean, I know we have business neighborhood, but like,
yeah.
this, what we did, we finally the old Simcoe building, is that or something? But what's your feeling, Gary, that we end up with like 3 business owners? Like one, maybe I'll call it the zero lot line, you know, for lot, and then one maybe for 10 to 15,000 square foot lot. You know what I mean? One for.
Yeah, I could see that. Originally, I was just thinking one. I was just thinking concentrating on the downtown mm-hmm. and then maybe expanding it to something like that afterwards.
Maybe up the road. So do one now and then up the road. So.
I mean, it's something we can talk about, though, if you feel strongly about it.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, something that I'd heard mentioned previously, you know, what changes, you know, would we envision or does the master plan envision downtown? And I think certainly. You know, more revitalization and reuse of existing buildings, but I'm not sure that people are interested in seeing a lot of redevelopment past along Main Street, past what's there.
No, right. I was just thinking it more, mm-hmm. if and then maybe we don't even have it. Do we have, and I'm thinking beyond this part of town, you know, on 138 past the, I know we just did the Cuisa commercial, but and maybe it's not needed. I'm just thinking, are there other parts of town where there's a large amount of business, you know, commercial zoning that is on small lots? And maybe not, maybe we handled it, maybe it's here in just the Cuisa commercial, which we just took care of. You know, as you go further down 138, okay. towards like Evolution, maybe yeah. those are larger,
I mean,
there.
Yeah. A little bit on Depot.
The only thing I could think is 5
not
Corners, but even that's
those are probably big for the most part. Yeah, I mean, a couple are small, but.
What right. about going north on 138? You know, those houses that have become businesses. I mean, they.
Yeah, but my thought is those are pretty big, huh? Right? Because a lot of those, that's.
That's the property yeah.
those. Those are those long, skinny lots that a lot of them are.
Roach Brothers up that way or further down?
Yeah, I'm talking about, you know, past Hilliard's and up that, you know.
Back from the
yeah, going towards back. Union Street and then
yeah,
past
exactly.
Union.
That area.
So.
Well, I could see past, I'll say the past Union as the train station comes in, I could see that may spur some development along there. And you know, at some point in the future, we might want to look at, you know, residents, areas that are within walking distance of the train station there.
Mm-hmm.
Not sure there's a lot of opportunity there because it's kind of fairly
right.
small lots.
Yeah, exactly.
But maybe that's a reason why we would, and plus you get across 138, which is a challenge.
Yeah, so maybe we do just do
focus
the small
this
focus right downtown. Yeah. For all the business we're going to have.
As far as saying like allowing residential, are we changing anything? Are we just going to keep the current uses?
We should talk about that next.
I'm trying to watch out for some, say like some of the larger lots. I don't want to turn it into a big apartment building.
Right. I mean, we don't really have an apartment.
I don't think we're going
to
touch any larger lots. Sorry.
What's that?
We're going to touch any larger lots?
No. And none of the
Our apartment regs require like 20,000 square feet per bedroom.
Should we cover recess?
So you're really not talking about anything.
So we're not changing that anyways.
No, I mean, I wouldn't think unless the board wanted to.
No, I don't want to, yeah.
But maybe that's the next conversation we should have is about use, take a look at the use table. And just, because there's questions, should we allow single family? I don't know. Should we allow duplexes? I don't know, but we should look at what's there and then, you know, have a discussion about what, you know, what uses are appropriate. There are probably some business uses that are allowed in the business zone that probably aren't appropriate downtown.
Mm-hmm.
I would imagine.
Yeah. I mean, I would think we would like to get away from having a single family.
I would think so, but I, you know. I
away from what?
Single family homes in that area.
Yeah. See that.
And again, all the single family would be non-conforming anyways. Probably, well, at least for a lot size. Mm.
But now, what about, like, say, like the way things currently are, sort of, you know, on Main Street, where there might be a restaurant on the bottom floor, then apartments on the top.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm not against the smaller. The way it is right now, I wouldn't be necessarily against more of that in a similar fashion.
Yep. So anything that's the way it is now would be grandfathered, mm-hmm. but you could, like we did in Quiset, you could say, you know, mixed use would be allowed via, you know, approval of the board or something.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think allowing some sort of apartment, like this kind of similar to what's
an apartment
right,
or two
similar to what's there right now. I don't think that's something that.
Yeah.
Was bad.
What's next, Chairman?
Last but not least, Quiset Commercial District Design Guidelines.
So before we go to that, Greg, what do you want to, we just talked about maybe next time we could start talking about use. That would be the next, take a look at the table uses. And all right. Okay. I don't have that electronically. I think, did everybody have a chance to look at it? Maybe we should just wait until next time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you want to?
Yeah.
It's been a long day.
I think that might be a good idea.
That's a good idea.
Oh, come on.
Make a motion to table that.
I don't take any more fun.
So I think we've got everything, right? Gary, do you have anything else?
I don't. The only thing is that we talked about some meeting date changes. And Pam, correct me if I'm wrong, but the meetings will be September 28th and October 14th. Change. So we have the 24th of August, then we have September 8th, and those are regularly scheduled. Mm-hmm. And then the two after that change. So it's September 28th and October 14th.
And we did this online, right?
We did, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I thought so. So there's no changes from what we all
No, no okay. changes from what
is
we did.
Is our next meeting September 8th?
So 28th?
Meeting is the 24th of August.
Okay, all right.
Okay, and then September 28th, and then what was it? October?
October 14th, which is a Wednesday, I believe.
Instead of the 5th?
Correct, yes. We get bumped on the 21st and the 5th.
Yeah, September 8th.
You got it.
Got it. No, I'm sorry. One more time. What was it? October 1?
Okay. September 8th, September
October 5th.
September 28th and October 14th are the meetings.
Because I didn't update that one.
Me either.
All right, Mr. Benson.
Motion to adjourn. Thank God.
Let's keep religion out of it. This is separation of church and state. All those in favor. Motion passes. Thank you, guys.